I'm accepted.
I'm forgiven.
I am fathered by the true and living God.
I'm accepted.
No
condemnation.
I am loved by the true and living God. There's no guilt or fear as I draw near to the Savior and Creator of the world. There is joy and peace as I release my worship to you, O Lord.
I'm accepted.
I'm forgiven.
I am fathered by the true and living God.
I'm accepted.
No condemnation.
I am loved by the true and living God. And there's no guilt or fear as I draw near to the Savior and Creator of the world. There is joy and peace as I release my worship to you, O Lord.
I'm accepted.
I'm forgiven.
I'm accepted.
And coming together at different times in different places, in different spaces, we know that we are held as one in you, our Lord and our God. As we bring our worship, receive it. And as we pray as one, we share in the words that Jesus gave us to say, saying together, Our Father in heaven, you are holy. May your will be done here on earth. May your kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. And give us today the food we need. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Strengthen us against all temptation. And deliver us from the time of trial. For the kingdom, the power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Before the throne of God above, I have a strong, a perfect plea, a great high priest whose name is love. Whoever lives and pleads for me, my name is graven on his hands, my name is written on his heart. I know that while in heaven he stands, no tongue can bid me thence depart, no tongue can bid me thence depart. When Satan tempts me to despair and tells me of the guilt within, upward I look and see him there who made an end to all my sin. Because the sinless Savior died, my sinful soul is counted free, for God the just is satisfied to look on him and pardon me, to look on him and pardon me. Behold him there, the risen Lamb, my perfect spotless righteousness, the great unchangeable I am, the King of glory and of grace. One with himself I cannot die, my soul is purchased by his blood, my life is hid with Christ on high, with Christ my Savior and my God, with Christ my Savior and my God.
The reading is taken from Luke chapter 23, verses 26 to 36. The crucifixion of Jesus. As the soldiers led him away, they seized Simon from Cyrene, who was on his way in from the country, and put the cross on him, and made him carry it behind Jesus. A large number of people followed him, including women who mourned and wailed for him. Jesus turned and said to them, "Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me, weep for yourselves and for your children. For the time will come when you will say, 'Blessed are the childless women, the wombs that never bore and the breasts that never nursed.' Then they will say to the mountains, 'Fall on us,' and to the hills, 'Cover us.' For if people do these things when the tree is green, what will happen when it is dry? Two other men, both criminals, were also led out with him to be executed. When they came to the place called the Skull, they crucified him there, along with the criminals, one on his right, the other on his left. Jesus said, 'Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing.' And they divided up his clothes by casting lots. The people stood watching, and the rulers even sneered at him. They said, 'He saved others. Let him save himself if he is God's Messiah, the chosen one.' The soldiers also came up and mocked him. They offered him wine vinegar." Amen.
Should boast,
grace, my God. Although vain things that charm me most, I sacrifice them to His blood. See, from His head, His hands, His feet, sorrow and love flow mingled down. Did e'er such love and sorrow meet, or thorns compose so rich a crown? Were the whole realm of nature mine, that were an offering far too small, love so amazing, so divine, demands my soul, my life, my all. Love so amazing, so divine, demands my soul, my life, my all.
Hello and welcome to our latest web worship series. This series is on forgiveness. Forgiveness as a principle of the Christian life. And I'm in the church recording these. This is a kind of a prelude to, hopefully, all things going as they are and as planned, the resumption of in-person services towards the end of October. And we will be producing a video to show you and to explain to you how that will work in practice. So do keep an eye out for that. It will be on our website, and we will post information about that on Facebook and the Clare for All page, as well as the church page. So I do invite you, if you're hoping to come to a service, if you can check that out in advance, you might find it will answer many of your questions. But our theme today is forgiveness. And this series came from an invitation that I put out to the congregation, to anyone who wished to make suggestions for possible preaching themes. If you don't remember that, well, it's not my fault for a start, but I can assure you I did, and you can check it out because I did also put it in the magazine. Only one suggestion was put forward. Someone asked for something on the theme of forgiveness. At first I thought, no problem. Very straightforward, probably only one sermon. But I think it's fair to say that I was wrong on that account. As I looked about it and as I've been mulling it over months, letting it stew and ferment at the back of my head, I think I've managed now to distill it down to this short series. And I recognise that I'm not giving it a lot of detailed exploration, but just giving a broad brush overview of it as a topic. The four that will make up the series really are just one that's been divided down into more manageable chunks. So they are connected, they do develop on from one another. This part of our reflection focuses on the nature of God as one who forgives. Luke records in his gospel that Jesus, when on the cross, cried out to his Father, "Forgive them, for they know not what they are doing." I remember as a child, and you probably are the same, saying and doing things that when we look back on them, we kind of shake our heads in disbelief. We recognize how much they must have hurt or offended someone at the time. In our naivety and immaturity, we have probably, possibly, all done or said things that we wouldn't do today. We may have been gently corrected at the time, or probably more simply just ignored, knowing that we were just children. When we think of our own society and culture, when we think of television programs from 40, 50 years ago that we were all thought were all so funny and oh so clever, we look at them now and think, you wouldn't get away with portraying that, doing that, saying that today. Perhaps it's a sign of the maturity of our community, our society. Let's hope so. But we will also have seen or heard reports from families of someone who has done some horrendous thing, saying that they don't understand it. They don't get why they did that. They were such good children, kind, loving. It might be simply the gaze of a parent's rose-tinted vision of their child, never to see the fault in their own. I don't know. Only they can answer that question. But in that instant on the cross, we see a watershed moment in God. It could have been that moment that said, I'm going to judge humanity for what it has done to my son. But it wasn't. God chose forgiveness. In Jesus' words, and you can almost hear the words and tone of one parent to the other parent saying, they don't understand, they don't get it. They're just children. If God were merely some divine judge or rule maker, such a pleading would have no traction, no hold. Rules are rules. Law is law. And punishment must follow offence. But right here from the start of Scripture, we begin to see a different portrait of God being painted in the lives and witness of his people, even when they got it so badly wrong. Exodus has many examples of this. Exodus 34, for example, when the people had made their golden calf, God had every right to punish, but instead, he affirms his loving nature and forgiveness. Exodus 34, 5 and 7. Then the Lord came down in the cloud and stood there with him and proclaimed his name, the Lord. And he passed in front of Moses, proclaiming, the Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness, maintaining love to thousands, and forgiving wickedness, rebellion, and sin. Yet he does not leave the guilty unpunished. He punishes the children and their children for the sin of their fathers to the third and fourth generations. So it's not that God is not able or willing to judge sin. He is, and he will. But there is forgiveness deep in his own being. A recognition that sin has consequences that must be played out. But God's desire is to forgive if our desire is to repent. Jeremiah 31 and from verse 31. This sums up the great and yet nature of God. And yet he says, the time is coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel, with the house of Judah, for I will forgive their wickedness. I will remember their sins no more. Will is a choice. I will do this. I will react in this way. It is my choice. God says, I will forgive their wickedness. I will remember their sins no more. The provision for this attitude of forgiveness that will become unchangeable is found in Christ. And it's prefigured before the cross at the Last Supper. Matthew 26 says, and he took the cup and gave thanks and offered it to them, saying, drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink of this fruit of the vine from now until the day when I drink it anew with you in my Father's kingdom. The signs and symbol of the new covenant in Christ to all the children of faith, the cup. It's restated. It is made manifest in those words on the cross. Father, forgive them. Our God is one who has chosen the path of forgiveness, not judgment. But as with so many things, it's a lot more complicated than that. Because forgiveness is dependent and predicated on repentance. We'll see how complex this becomes over the next few reflections. If we're going to be God's people in the world, we are to reflect God's nature into that world. God's nature as shown in Christ and in our lives. Paul, in one of his more ecstatic expositions about Jesus and God, writes to the church in Colossae these words in Colossians 1, it's quite a long reading, 15 to 23. He says this about Jesus: we look at this Son and see the God who cannot be seen. We look at this Son and see God's original purpose in everything created, for everything. Absolutely everything above and below, visible and invisible, rank after rank after rank of angels. Everything got started in him and finds its purpose in him. He was there before any of it came into existence and holds it all together right up to this moment. And when it comes to the church, he organizes and holds it together. Like a head does a body. He was supreme in the beginning and leading the resurrection parade. He is supreme in the end. From beginning to end, he's there, towering far above everything, everyone. So spacious is he, so roomy, that everything of God finds its proper place in him without crowding. Not only that, but all the broken and dislocated pieces of the universe, people and things, animals and atoms, get properly fixed and fit together in vibrant harmonies. All because of his death, his blood that poured down from the cross. You yourselves are a case study of what he does. At one time, you had your backs turned to God, thinking rebellious thoughts of him, giving him trouble every chance you got. But now, by giving himself completely at the cross, actually dying for you, Christ brought you over to God's side and put your lives together, whole and holy, in his presence. You don't walk away from a gift like that. You stay grounded and steady in that bond of trust, constantly tuned to the message, careful not to be distracted or diverted. There is no other message, just this one. Every creature under heaven gets the same message. I, Paul, am a messenger of this message. I know it was a long reading, and do feel free to read it over again a few times yourself. That particular translation was from the Message, which gives a bit more immediacy and power to the words, I feel. But what it says is that what Christ does, how he reacts, how he engages, is God doing, reacting, engaging. So when Christ says, Father, forgive, it's within God's heart to forgive. And he will respond to the pleading of his Son. And its purpose, this forgiving nature of God, has a deeper purpose. And Paul touches on it in Ephesians 4:13. Until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. Fullness of Christ in us. If the fullness of Christ is in us and it's to be realized, then we need to seek the fullness of God in us. And that must be reflected in our nature, becoming like his nature, his purpose. At the core and heart of God is forgiveness. So from this foundation, this starting point, we will consider the forgiveness of God. How do we know it? The measure by which we are to forgive. And conclude with forgiveness as a principle of living in God. I hope you'll want to journey with me on that journey through the main points of the landscape of forgiveness. It will be a bit of a pilgrimage that may challenge and change us, change our thinking and our understanding, change how we live our faith.
Heavenly and loving Father, we bring before you the needs of your world, a world in so many places in conflict, in confusion, in brokenness, facing the challenges of over-industrialization, of climate change, of pollution, all that these things bring to our lives. We pray for those in the poorest parts of our world, whose lives seem blighted by the decisions of the rich nations. Open our eyes to their needs. Grant us an understanding of their lives, that we may work for their good and their blessing. And open the eyes and hearts of leaders in all nations to work for peace and justice. We pray for nations moving to elections such as America, that it would be without excessive conflict, where the language of abuse would be given over for the language of reconciliation. Father, raise up men and women in all nations who will lead their people in truth and in justice. Father, we pray for people, men and women and boys and girls, all whose lives have been damaged or broken by the actions of others, through abuse or oppression, through violence or warfare. Father, we pray for their healing and their restoration. As we scan the papers, we see and read so many stories from around the world that seem so hopeless, so full of despair. Lord, we pray that you would raise up men and women in all lands working for the restoration of all people in accordance with your will and your plan and your purpose. Grant them enthusiasm, grant them hope, grant them zeal, we pray, through Christ our Lord. And finally, Father, give us a vision for our future. Give us a sense of your purpose in us and how we can change the world around us. Give us hope. Give us hope that we can really share your truth and your hope and your gospel with the world. May we do it with love and forgiveness in our hearts and in our lives. May we live you before others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. Sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior. How great thou art.
take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then shall I bow in humble adoration. Sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee. How great Thou art! How great Thou art! Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee. How great Thou art!
May we grow in our understanding of God's deep heart, His forgiveness, His love and compassion for us, His children. And may that knowledge inspire us and lead us to do wonderful things in His name, for His sake and His glory, now and always. Amen.